The following day, Wednesday, January the 28th, 2009, Rockhill Barracks on the outskirts of Letterkenny closed as well. Rockhill House, a fine period building, dates back to the 1600s. It opened as a barracks in 1969 with almost 30 acres of land. It became the headquarters of B Company, 28th Infantry Battalion and 24th Infantry Battalion, FCA. In the lead-up to the closure, many local people attended an open day at the barracks. The final day's ceremonies were meticulously planned. For the last time, an inspection of the troops took place, and this was followed by the ceremonial lowering of the flag.
From an operational point of view, I don't think that there are grounds for keeping all the border posts open. I was just discussing in there with the commanding officer here, Lieutenant Colonel McDaniels. At one stage, at the height of the troubles in the early, late 70s and the 80s, we had something like 14 border posts. Now, I think the fact that after today we're now down to 3 reflects the security situation up here along the border area. It's not one to worry anymore. But as I say, if we do have to get troops, we have the means and the capabilities to get troops into any area in Ireland that we need to very, very quickly.
It was a time for reflection and memories about Rockhill.
28 Battalion was set up to provide border security in the Donegal area with three posts, one in Finna, which was the headquarters, one in Rockhill and one in Lifford. And since 1973, certainly they have been providing border security, checkpoints in the border, both mobile and permanent. In the early days, we had gel ignite escorts, explosives escorts, and we've had bank duties, and we've had mobile patrols all throughout the county, and we were there to react to any situation that arose.
I'd come here in 72. It had been actually late 72. I arrived from Athlone. I was stationed in Athlone prior to that. Came here in 72, and I've been here since.
When I was company commander here in the 80s, you had a company in the region of 250. And then you would have a maintenance staff of approximately 10 who kept the place ticking over and looked after all the internal internal and external maintenance.
I remember one Friday night, I arrived in from the Fiesta. I was going with the wife at the time, Veronica. And I arrived in, and I said to the boys in the gate, I says, I know watch on me for some reason, must have left it behind me. I says, what time is it? And they told me at around about 4:30 sometime in the morning. So I was sleeping up in a room way up the back of the house, and I didn't seem to be at the time in the bed until I was wakened up, and I was the company sergeant, and I says, yeah, I thought I'd slept in. I thought it was earlier, later on in the day. I actually thought I'd slept in, and he says, get up, and I says, what time is it? 5:30, and I says, would you ever, you know, off? And he says, no, get up, he says, you're taking a patrol out. That was out to an incident that happened out to Kilclean, where two men foolishly blew themselves up. They were transporting a bomb from one car to another. They were actually going into Northern Ireland to plant a bomb, and the two of them blew themselves to bits. That was a horrific moment. You know, to actually go in, myself and another fellow, a Sergeant Doherty had served here, we actually walked into the wooded area and found one of the bodies. It was a gruesome sight to see. That was the first introduction, shall we say, that I had to the troubles in Northern Ireland that actually happened on this side of the border.
In the early 70s, with a team Rockhill United, which was formed by Colonel Declan O'Carroll, was very successful and won a couple of Donegal leagues, but it also provided an outlet for the soldiers here. The duties were long, and it was every Sunday we'd get together and play the games, you know, and on a Monday morning, depending on how the game went, there'd be a lot of slagging, you know, but then you look forward to the next week. But it definitely was a good focus, the football team that was here, definitely over the years, you know.
What was going through your mind today now when the flag was being taken down for the last time?
Well, there was one fellow I was thinking about, you know. I remember him going overseas to Lebanon, Hughie Doherty, sticks very much in my mind. Hughie was tragically killed in the early stages of that trip. And also my good friend Harry Cassidy, who I served here with. Harry would have been probably my best friend. He took over my job. It's memories like that, you know, and other people have gone, Peter Ivers in particular, who was here, you know, was just part of the house, like, you know.
We had a reputation of the house being haunted, like. So in one of the rooms upstairs, there was actually 10 of us sleeping in the one room, and you're practically sleeping on top of one another. So if you put your hand out of the bed, like, you'd have slapped the little boy beside you in the face, like. So we're all snuggled down for the night anyhow after coming back from a border patrol. And the next thing, we heard this boy squealing. Of course, one of the good boys, you see, kept his hand out of the bed, like, it was really cold, and slapped your man across the face with a cold hand, like. And he jumped up. So anyhow, we got him settled down. We got him settled down again and said, look, one of the boys from the act needs it. When you get back into your bed again, you know. He settled down for a while, and at that particular time there was no central heating. It was all turf fires in the place, right? So when we actually had a big fire on before we left, by the time we come back from patrol again, it was just smouldering away, like, you know. So we're going to our bed anyhow, so there was no more fuel added to it, like. But there was a fella from Athlone, very quiet fella, called him Murphy, and just went about, hardly spoke to anybody, you know. But what we didn't realise was he had a bottle of oil, and he poured it over the hot ashes. So after about an hour, it started to build up a gas. The next thing, the flame blew out of the fireplace. Your boy jumped out of the bed. and down the stairs, and could we get him back into that room that night again? He was actually swore the place was haunted. So that was one of the funnier moments of it.
You know, there's a lot of people who have a lot of attachments to up here. Spent a lot of the time up here, did a lot of work up here. Spent a lot of time, particularly, you know, maintaining the house and building up relationships with the community. You know, whereas we're going to make sure we keep these relationships, it's still a sad day.
It is, you know, a thing in the army that once you're attached to a place like this, the links with the place tend to be kept on. And you'll find, you know, I would say plenty of your troops would be available for St. Patrick's Day parades here.
Certainly, ceremonial and all the rest, yeah. We'll make sure we keep the links that we have up here.
By the nature of the profession, you have to go where you're sent. So the soldiers will quickly settle into Finner. That's not a problem. So, you know, they'll just move from one place to the other. And I don't think in a very short period of time, they will have served with all the guys in Finner anyway, so that would be no big problem for them.
Lifford and Rockhill were also used as training bases for the Reserve Defence Forces. The closure of these barracks will also see their operations move to Finner Camp.
The RDF are going to be the one, I suppose, the worst affected at the moment. As you say, from the nearest now RDF, where the weapons are based, will be Finner. For training, as you know, midweeks, you know, as you say, any young person joining the RDF, what is the first thing they want? It's probably to get a hands on a weapon. You know, it means a lot more travel than probably weekend camps in Finner. You know, there's a lot of, I say, sorting out to be done there yet, and hopefully recruitment won't be affected by it, because the RDF is very important in North Donegal.
The Mayor of Letterkenny, Councillor Victor Fisher, expressed his regret at the closure.
Very sad day, and well, I'd like to wish all the fellas all the best, and I know it's not going to be easy travelling to Finner away all hours in the morning. It's not going to be easy for families that they're married on. Very inconvenient for a lot of people, and sadly, like, it's in the time of recession, when the country's in big trouble, this is going to cost money, 10 million to cost maybe, and I think it's terrible, like, at the moment, like, we're going to save that money.
On a dull afternoon, reflecting the sombre atmosphere, the troops marched out of the barracks. Shortly afterwards, marched through the centre of Letterkenny.